So I was saying earlier on that at Rhemma Consult, we offer a comprehensive immigration services that is tailored to meet the diverse needs of our clients worldwide, including specialized assistance for individuals to self-petition for employment-based green cards, empowering them to take control of their immigration journey. So whether you are an employer seeking to harness global talent, a professional aiming to work in the US, or an individual looking to invest in a US business, we are here to help you. Our employment-based green card services cover a range of categories, including green cards for extraordinary ability EB1A, outstanding researchers and professors EB1B, multinational executive and managers EB1C, PEM labor certification EB2, EB3, national interest waiver EB2, as well as a physician national interest waiver Schedule A. That green cards for nurses and physical therapists. And we understand that immigration is not just about paperwork, it's about dreams, aspirations, building a better future. That's why we offer this individual family immigration services to assist individuals and families in navigating the complexities of temporary visas, marriage-based visas, and green cards. In fact, at Rhemma Consult, we prioritize personalized attention, ensuring that each client receives dedicated support and expertise needed to achieve their immigration goals with confidence and peace of mind. That being said, now let's get into why we are here today. So, first, the question would be for our client who is in the person of OB. Maybe let's give you a couple of minutes to for you to kind of tell us a little bit about yourself and what you would like to share. OB, you can come off mute and then
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you loud and clear.
All right. Thank you so much for having me. So, I'm from Nigeria with a bachelor's of agriculture in and I majored in animal science. I had a master's also in Nigeria, in the northern part of Nigeria also. And I'm now here in the United States for a PhD in animal sciences. Do you know, need any further details?
No, I think that is great. We get to know you as well. So I guess the most important question is, how do you feel about the approval notice? Are you satisfied with this outcome?
Oh yeah. Like basically that's what you want to hear, like being approved, because it's gonna be so crazy not being approved, like not even thinking of the money, the stress. Yeah. It's satisfactory. Yeah, I'm so satisfied.
Okay, that's great. This interview is going to take a little bit of a different tone because Obi happens to be a client that got an RFE, and we were the people that initially submitted it, and he still got an RFE. So it's going to be a very different form of an interview from the past, since he's basically was our first clients to get an RFE in a long while. So can you share your initial reaction when receiving the RFE?
So, receiving the RFE news was from you, because that's one good job you do. You actually keep on checking our status for us. Like, I don't bother checking. I know I have someone like you that will always keep on checking. So it was one evening, I think in April, I was working on the farm that evening and I missed your call. And I later called you when I got home, and you were like, "Have you checked your status?" I was like, "No, I don't check anything." And you're like, "Oh, you receive an RFE." Like, I have never done that. Like, wow, this is serious. So I've heard of RFE before, but you don't really understand what RFE means until you have one. Because basically, I was that evening, I couldn't sleep. I was watching YouTube videos to have an understanding of what RFE is. I got to church. I knew it was a Saturday. You called me. On Sunday, I got to church. I knew a friend that actually got approved for EB2. So I was like, have you heard of RFE before? It was like, oh, yeah. I had a friend that had an RFE, 14 pages. I was like, wow. And then if you get a message for RFE, it takes a while before you get an email, the copy of the RFE itself, because they have to mail it to you. And some couple of days later, I think like a week, I got the RFE. It was like 7 pages. I was like, what is this? And when I quickly made a copy, I sent it to you. And I was reading in between the line, and I noticed that these guys do a thorough job of reading the petition, because they actually gave places where I talked about in the petition, and they were telling me, no, you're supposed to do something else and not this. It was so thorough. I was like, what is this? And I remember talking to Doki. Sorry, I'm talking, if I'm saying Doki, I'm talking about Dr. Imana. So I remember talking to you, and I was like, this thing is too much. Like, what is the meaning of this? I don't understand. YouTube, which is very crazy. I was down, like, but thank God I talked with different people. And you are also telling me, oh, don't worry, we'll read about it. We don't need to reply immediately. Which we took time to really understand what they actually wanted. It got to a time in which, like, I was like, Doki's not even responding. He's not sending me anything again. But I remember you calling and saying, oh, no, I need to know a lot about this thing, so I don't want to disturb you. And I remember then also you were kind of sick. So then, yeah, we couldn't talk a lot. So you were researching about it. I was also researching about it and asking a lot of people. It got to a time in which I even had to reach out to a friend that has a lawyer friend. And I remember you messaging me and saying, do you want to give this to a lawyer to reply your RF? I said, no, I just want to have a better understanding. And like, if you actually come from different angles to answer them, different people's idea, we might be able to actually respond very well to this RFE. It's a long story though, but do you think I should continue talking about it, or is there something else? I should continue.
No,
Okay.
anything,
So,
yeah, just feel free.
yeah, so I remember reaching out to friends in church, reaching. Watching a lot of YouTube videos, and I started understanding, oh, RFE is a normal thing, and it's actually common. And one video I watched most importantly was saying RFE usually come if you apply. Most time it comes for people that apply for premium, just to actually give you like an hold back before they actually look at your petition, because there are a lot of people that are applying for premium, though I'm not sure, but that's his own idea. So we have different people, different ways in which they think we should actually answer the RFE. I remember talking with Ducky. We had a lot of WhatsApp messages, calls, and it was like, we can get different people's idea. Let us finish writing a reply to them. You check it, give me feedback. I'll give it to someone to give me feedback so that we have different eye on it. And at the end of the day, thank God, we submitted the RFE, and it took almost more than a month before they gave a reply. And I remember also the day they gave a reply, it was in the morning. I was sleeping. I woke up to your message again. I was like, have you seen that your status have been changed to being actively reviewed? I was like, I don't understand what that means. But okay, hopefully. And you said, hopefully, in the next couple of hours, we should get a reply. And got so good. I kept on checking. I was even in the lab. It was around 11. And they said it has been approved. And I actually had to message you immediately, like, no, they have approved it. I called my wife. No, they approved the RFE. Oh my God. And I had to go outside, leave the lab, and get a chilled Coke to cool down. it was a lot. Like, then I understand what RFE is, because basically, if you don't have one, there's nothing like RFE until you have one.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, and just to clarify a little bit of some of the things. So, yeah, at Rhemma Consult, we've helped a lot of people with RFE, but this was the first time. Most of the people that we help with RFE are people from like lawyers, like other clients that didn't use Rhemma Consult, but they got the RFE and then they would come to us to help. But this was the very first time that we have taken a client from start to scratch, and then we got the RFE as a result of our response that we sent. So this was really a challenging one, because most of the RFEs that we usually get are from people who use lawyers and maybe did it by themselves, and now they have RFE and they want a technical eye. So yes, then we, it was a really big one to look at as well. So That being said, how did you learn about Rhemma Consult?
So, I think I was on the street of LinkedIn, and I saw one of your posts in which someone just got EB2, and I think the person had maybe two citations or something, I can't remember. So I was like, ah, two citations, is this person real? So that was the first time I came across Rhemma Consult. And so from your LinkedIn, I noticed you have a YouTube. I saw lots of videos. I took my time to watch those videos, like videos of interviews like this. And I was like, wow, so it's possible. Because my experience about about green card itself is just that when people talk about NIW, they will tell you, oh, you have to have lots of publications, you have to have citation. I think people are making mistake between EB1 and EB2. So you have to have citations, you have to have paper published in the US and all that. So when I started seeing them and listening to watching those videos, I felt, okay, is this really possible? So I remember sending you a LinkedIn message that day, and I was like, good evening, Ducky. Are you sure this is real? Because I don't believe. And you were like, oh yeah, we can actually have a consultancy. No, yeah, you asked me for a brief about myself. So I told you, and you were like, oh, let us have a consultancy in which we talk about like an hour in which we look at your CV and what you have, and we talk about what you have if you can actually get it. So I remember we scheduled a meeting, and we talked. And I told you what I have. I showed you my CV, and you were like, what are you waiting for? Why haven't you applied for this thing and all that? I'm like, no, the news or the info I have is that you have to have a lot of things. You have to have publication in the US. I don't have publication in the US. I don't have lots of citations. At that point, yeah, at that point, I had six citations. And it was basically from papers in which I have in Nigeria. And I have like 12 papers then. And you were like, that's a lot. And I told you in the US, I don't have paper, but I have abstract like four. And you were like, oh, that would really make a good one. And I remember even during the interview, you started telling me, I don't really know a lot about the petition. And you started telling me, oh, we can take it from this angle, maybe from sustainability and link it up to animal something, something. And we talked about, I was like, wow, I never thought in this angle. And even within an hour, you started telling me the way in which we can actually answer it. And you said, when would you like to say that? And I was like, I would like to think about it. And I took my time, maybe like 2 weeks. I talked with my wife. I talked with friends. I further waited on your update on LinkedIn. And later on, I reached out to you like, yeah, I need to start this thing.
Okay, so you did. Yeah, I remember. I even think before we did the consultation, correct me if I'm wrong, like you were somewhere in a conference and you said you had to come back from a conference, right?
Sure. Yes. Yes.
You were in a conference and you
And
came back, right?
permit me to say this. I
Okay.
remember even before we went on the real consultancy 1 hour meeting, we talked at length, and I was like, do you do this to everybody? Because you are actually giving me private information even before I'm telling you, like you're telling me how you would do it, how you go about it. And I was like, do you do this to everybody? You're giving me all this info. Do you think I can write this on my own? But I felt like, this is not for me. I just said, let me give it to someone. And I remember when I got my first draft, I was like, no, I would never be able to write this within this short time. Never. Maybe it would take me a year.
No, I still think you would have been able to. Yeah, it was yes, but I take that compliment as well. So, you did eventually come for consultation, but what was the thing that you decided to move forward with Rhemma Consult? Like, why didn't you go somewhere else? Like, why did you decide to stick with Rhemma Consult?
Okay, truthfully, I had not followed a lot of people about NIW, though I used to see videos online. Then I remember sending my application to a lawyer, like that was early, no, late 2022. And lawyer was like, maybe you should have like 3 more years of experience and have papers and all that. It's a very popular law firm in the US. And I was like, okay. So when, and they never even told me that you don't need to have citation and all that, which you told me later. And I remember you even sharing USCIS website with me, like, go and look, read about it. I think the problem we have is just that we don't like reading. If it's not my research, I don't want to read about it. So you were like, this is it. It's plain, written in black and white. Just read it. These are what they want. If it's not this, they don't want this. But if you have more than this, you can put it into your application. So necessarily, I didn't reach out to a lot of people about NIW because when I started talking to you, I felt safe. I felt I was in safe hands. And the way you took your time to explain to me, even though I've not given you a dime, like I felt, oh, if this person can be upfront with this leader, I'm very sure that he's very good at what he's doing. And when you sent my first draft, I knew I didn't make a mistake. Because I was like, how did you do this? I remember then you sent it overnight. And I woke up to a long petition of like, I think 30 pages or so. I was like, Ducky, how are you able to write this within this short time? Because I think we have like, we scheduled to write this for like a month, I guess, or 2 months. And within a week, you gave him back. I was like, how are you doing this? Are you doing some sort of magic or something? But yeah, I felt safe with you. I felt safe, like you were upfront showcasing like the people that have actually gone through you. It's not as if you are faking people or faking it. Like, I checked these people that you have actually gone work with online, and I saw that they are real people and they're not fake. So and I was never necessarily concerned there, because some people were, I remember talking with someone, it was like, are you sure he's just working with Ghanaians alone? Maybe it's just his country. I was like, no, this person is even in the US with me. I know his name. I know everything about him. The people in which he's putting online also, these people have online contacts and you can see it there. So it's not fake. So I felt safe with you. So I don't need to necessarily go and check with someone else.
Gotcha. That's interesting. Well, I also enjoyed working with you as well. So because you did have the RFE, we'll be going back and forth between the write-up and then the RFE. So there'll be some questions there. So how did Rhemma Consult's response strategy help you regain confidence in the approval after the RFE was received?
So initially, when they gave RFE, there were like some space before we started actually responding. And then when there was space and we were not talking, I felt Ducky is not really concerned about this thing again. But I remember you called me and you were like, oh, I'm thinking about the way we'll be doing this thing. Then you made a folder, I remember, for RFE then, and you gave the strategy of the way in which you want to go about it. But you were like, we have 3 whole months. Let's take time to think about things we can pull in. So you gave me some structures in which I looked at, and you were the one even filling it in gradually. Though it was not a lot for the first like 1 month, which I was really worried, like, 90 days before you know it, it's almost here. But the magic happened within just a week, like every other thing. Later on, when we got the idea of what we were supposed to do, like, I remember you saying, oh, maybe we should get more recommendation later from, like, because one of the points they made in the RFE was independent researchers. So we should get more RFEs. Then, if possible, we should get RFEs from the people in which I've done research with, like company. I should get recommendations from people that have actually used my work, cited my work, which we tried. So, funniestly, we tried reaching out to some researchers, and some would not even reply you back, and some would doesn't want to answer you. But at the end of the day, we were able to get out some few recommendation letter. We attached it to the new write-up, and we submitted.
And just so that it would help a couple of people, tell us a little bit about your citation record. Like, do you have a lot of citations? Just so that people will understand the nuances as well.
So at the point of submitting my petition, initially, I had 6 citations. But, Ducky, I didn't even tell you this. So later on, like last month, I think there are some nuances in my ResearchGate and Google Scholar, like the way in which my name was spelled. So they give you ways in which you can actually change different names. Like, let's say OBI. You might say I or B might be in a paper. So there are some nuances in the way in which some papers actually publish your paper. So later on, when I actually corrected those, I had 13 citations. 13, which was not like what we submitted. We submitted with just 6 citations. So and then I was like, are you sure this citation is not too small? Are you sure my publication is not too small? And I don't have a publication ready in the US for now, and you were like, oh, don't bother about all that. People even from back home in Africa have actually done these things. They don't even have a paper in the US. And you made mention of yourself, like, oh, when I submitted mine, I don't have any citation. Even people that have no publication, at least you have to have a publication before you have a citation. People that don't even have a publication are getting this thing. It just depends on the way in which you structure the petition in which you are submitting to them and the way in which you can preach yourself to them so that they will understand what you're doing. Because it's not about the jargon sometimes. I remember sometimes you tell me, okay, you've done this thing, trying to tell me in layman terms. I will tell you and be like, hey, that one is better than what you are saying. So these people, they are not like academics or scientific, sort of call it. They are just like maybe people with physiology or I don't know, with a bachelor's, and they don't really understand what you're saying unless you tell them in a way in which they need to understand. So you actually helped me to divulge what I wanted to say from the core jargon to the literary man. And that makes sense, really. Because even when I was talking to you, apart from NIW, I learned a lot because we have different audiences in which we talk to. So sometimes you need to break down your level of expertise when you're talking to a different audience entirely.
Definitely true. And can you highlight one or two projects that you worked on that we discussed in your petition as well?
Sorry, can you repeat the question?
Can you talk about one or two projects that
Yeah.
we added as part of the petition so that people get a sense of how great your work and its impact has in the specifically in the work of poetry and techie here as
Yeah.
well?
Yeah, so I work in the disease ward with animal disease, and the animal disease really affects the amount of animals that is being produced worldwide, not even the US alone. So we talked about how my research would be able to actually help to reduce the amount of disease in which we have amongst animals, ultimately helping to reduce the losses from farmers and also people having access to high quality meat, which actually helped the economy of the United States in the long run. So I remember I worked on a research about a particular disease then, and we also added that and its value of what it would give to the US. Because most time, the research we do is just more scientific, but a lot of people don't know the economic effect of what we are doing. So, and that is what they want to know about, the economic effect and not just the scientific jargon in which we are doing. So you made us to on made me to understand that so this project we need to how would I put it, we need to fit it in so that they will understand what we're doing. So I remember doing a project for a company. I think we did like three projects for a company in which we actually put inside the petition, and there was a way in which you also added my abstract in which we presented in conferences to the petition. It was a long one. I was like, how did you do all this? So there is a way in which we chip in all those ideas, all those different projects into the petition, and that actually really helps.
For me, I think that your research really has a lot of national implications. Just imagine like you going to Walmart and you can't find like there's no chicken, there's no poultry like for about a month, because maybe all of them are dead according to the disease you're studying. Like literally, like over time we are going to start starving, right? So your work has more than your scientific implications. Like it's in terms of health, you're giving us good food so that we don't eat things that have like diseases, and also you are making sure that the economy is growing. So definitely there are a lot of implications that you're already doing wonderful work that we spoke about. So I guess going back a little bit into transparency, like did you find transparency in the whole process?
Transparency is relative. So what are you actually, what are you aiming for me to answer on?
Well, you kept well informed and updated throughout the entire process. Did you
Oh,
find
yeah.
Rhemma to be upfront in terms of communication and questions?
Oh, sure. Like, you are the one even chasing me then. Because I'll tell you, Doki, you know I'm busy in the lab. I will be on the farm. You'll be like, must you be on the farm every time? You kept on chasing, like, you have a calendar in which you're following. We both have a calendar in which we are following. But you had a way in which you actually made or shortened the calendar to actually fit it, because you're like, in 2 months we should be done. But I remember it didn't even take us a month before we finished everything, because you're about like, Demi or B, I sent you this thing. Can you actually check your email now? Reply to it now. Now I'll be like, no, I can't reply immediately. I need to finish things I'm doing. Be like, okay, you know, you're the one delaying me right now. So you actually kept me on my feet. There are some days in which I get home late and get home to your messages, and I'll be like, oh, I need to do this. You need to work on your CV right now. You sent me a template of what I work on. I'll be like, oh, this is a whole lot. Then you'll be like, okay, when you're done, put it in the folder. I sent you a screenshot of what I've done. I'll send it to you. And you actually send me a feedback almost immediately. Or unless it's late that I send it to you, because sometimes I work late. So I send it to you late. And some days, you two, you are always up late, replying me like, oh, do you think we are good to go with this? Okay, I'll send you this other one in which you need to work with. You should send it back to me tomorrow. I'll be like, okay, I won't be able to make it tomorrow. So you actually kept me on my feet, which was actually very nice. Though it was a lot, I won't lie to you. Like, it was a lot, but you kept on. You are the one that would delay us from submitting this petition. Do you think we can submit next week Tuesday? I'll be like, I don't know. If you tell me we can submit, it's dependent on you. Just make sure you do everything I ask you to do. So basically, it was a transparent one. You were actually the one keeping me on my feet to actually do a lot of things, like yes, to send you feedback and all that, which was really good, because necessarily we are busy and there's no time. But if you don't do like that, I believe even till now we'll still be on it.
As a culture, guys, I found out that you guys are almost always on the farm, right? One of our clients that got an approval some few months ago also was an agricultural like researcher in North Dakota, and he was always on the farm. Sometimes like he was working more with pigs, so you know, sometimes he works with delivery. So you guys are always on the farm, like doing something overnight. I was like, wow, you guys are doing so wonderful things, making sure that before the food comes to us, it's good and we have great impact. So yeah, definitely, you guys are always almost busy. And I find that in most of the lab guys as well, like most of the time. But yeah, definitely enjoyed working with DOB as well. So how would you rate Rhemma Consult? So we are going a little back into the RFE. How would you rate Rhemma Consult's expertise in dealing with the complexities of the RFE?
Yeah, so at first I was like, when we got the RFE and I was not getting feedback, I'm like, are you sure Doki will be able to do this thing? I was really worried and all that. But over time, when you shared me like the way in which you want to go about it, and when you sent me the first draft of the RFE petition, I was like, oh wow. So like, I understand, like, though I'm a novice, you are an expert in what you're doing, and you showcase the expertise. Because it's not about talking sometimes. It's about, we won't talk to USCIS. We need to show them something. But when I got what we were supposed to show to USCIS, I was like, oh no, this is really great. It's normal for us to feel shaky sometimes, which is normal. We are humans. And you actually changed everything when I got the petition, and I was like, oh wow, how are you able to come up with this again? Because that's the question I always ask. And you'll be like, oh, that's my work, I'm supposed to do it and all that. So you show a sense of professionalism in what you do. You show how expert you are. It's not about just jumping the gun and trying to rush to get feedback. When you take the necessary precaution, you would get a better result.
Okay. Definitely. We enjoy that you find that our service was professional, and there were a lot of thought thinking, and that's one of the things that we at Rhemma Consult here, myself and my associates, we take the time and the pride that we were all once like non-immigrants, and so we understand the complexity. So most of our clients are not just numbers, they are lives. We know that they are fathers, their mothers, their brothers, their sisters. And so we are prayed a little bit different, and we are not just like a number. So we put a lot of thoughts as well into it. So before we get a little bit into the end of the questions, I guess based on your experience, like, can you share some specific aspects of our services that stood out to you during the collaborating.
So I think the most important thing which I got from you was communication was key. Then the way in which you did the work was not like it's from a business perspective. Like it's in it my service I offer and that's it. It's more like a lifelong relationship in which you are like, oh, it's my brother. Because you always make jest of me. I think during the that was, is it the Nations Cup that you are making jest of me
I
about
don't know why this
Nigeria?
guy calls me Doki. He calls me Doki. So if you're Nigerian, please help me. Is do they call Dr. Doki? Or
Oh
he, the
yeah,
guy
that's
always
what we
calls me
call
Doki,
Doctor.
Doki, Doki. Me too, Doki. From where I come from, it's like you're a duck. So the guy keeps calling me Doki like I'm a
Oh
duck.
no,
But
it's a doctor.
yeah.
Yeah,
Oh, I see. I see.
that's
Man,
what we
people
call
have
doctor.
people from Nigeria. Oh,
Just to
I have
be a
people
little
from
bit
Nigeria.
informal, you just say Doki instead of saying doctor. Because some
Okay,
people
I
say
see.
you're too formal saying doctor. So you say, oh, Doki, that's
Oh,
more a little bit informal. So
okay.
yeah, it's the relationship that is being built during the process and even after the process was the main thing I saw. And the professional feedback in which you give to me and others. Because I remember even before I finished writing my petition, I started telling people about Rhemma Consult. And I would tell them, oh, reach out to Doki. And if the person said he can't, you did not respond to his message or email, I'd be like, oh, let me message him. He'll respond to me. He's busy, I know. He'll respond to me. So the kind of relationship in which he gave was more of not just business, but more of like a brother that is actually trying to make his brother grow. It's more like that. So it's been like I've been there, I've gone through these, not just as a business person, but even as a person myself, as someone that is also applying, I've been there. So your relationship was really one thing that stood out to me. Then the level of expertise in what you do and the feedback you give was also another thing. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And the another thing is like the level at which you do your work, how fast you give feedback. Is another thing I really cherish.
Definitely. What would you say to people that are considering using the services of Rhemma Consult?
So, as I said earlier, even before I got my approval, I started recommending Rhemma Consult. So, if people that are considering using Rhemma Consult, please. And please make your findings like me. I did my own assignment also to check about Rhemma. And it's good to like have options, but I'm telling you, if you use him, you won't feel regretted because he's good at what he does. That's just basically what I would tell people. Like, just do your assignment first so that it won't be as if someone is mandating you to do something. Just do your assignment, like what you're doing and joining this interview, this call. It's another way to actually know more about him and how good he is with what he does. So please and please make your assignment, make your feedback, and actually you can work with him. He's a great man to work with, I can tell you that.
We're a great client to work with as well.
Thank
In
you.
as much as we always try to provide the best services, we do know that we always want to keep learning, right? So that we better serve the diverse needs of our clients. For example, you are a diverse client to us, you are first Nigerian. Well, over time, I've had a couple of Nigerians, but you are the first Nigerian that I'm interviewing for an approval. What are
Good,
some of
good.
the areas you think Rhema could improve that would make your work a little bit much better?
Okay. I would like to try to think about it right now. Nothing is coming up like in areas in which you need to improve. So it won't be as if Rema is an A student. I won't say A plus because we all have there's always room for improvement. That's just the truth. Yeah. So truthfully he's an L person, but there's always a place in which we think he can actually improve on. Maybe, I don't know. I'm trying to think about it. Because even trying to think about it, there are some things you did that I never talked about. Like at the point of submission when we were printing, that I had to make videos and send to you. I'd be like, no, that one is not clear enough. You need to print it again. Or you make me a better video. Like there are some things you did that I'd be like, no, this is exceptional. Like the way in which you help us to gather our documents. Even when I was submitting, when I got to FedEx, you were like, read out the address they are sending it to me. I read it like 2 times before they actually posted it, which was actually very funny. So let me compare you with another law firm that I knew someone that I've worked with. The thing I knew they do in the law firm is they are the one that print for the people that they are working with. So I believe you can do that for maybe people that are back in Africa, because you can actually take your time to actually check in more. Or even people that are here, it's just that they have to pay you for printing. That's just it. Or you include it in the money which people are paying. I'm just saying, I know some people will not agree on that, but to me, I believe it's good. Like, then, because some people want to see what they are actually submitting and, like, oh, he said he submitted. Because another problem with our people is just that when you say I submitted this, they'll be like, if there is, like, God forbid, there was, like, an RFE, they'll be like, oh, he's the one that sent it. I don't know what he submitted. So it's scary sometimes also. But another way is, a level of professionalism, you can send all documents in which you are submitting and you'll be the one to print everything. You don't even need to make a video, just send a picture, because I believe in what you're doing. So just send a picture of like the total packet. This is what we are submitting to them. I'm mailing it out. You send them the amount in which they are paying for the mailing and all that, which helps. Because I know people back home need someone to help them print. Even here, some people need some people to help them print. I'm just taking that as an option. It might not be compulsory, but you can say, okay, there's this option of me printing and helping you do this. Would you want to go for it? Because I know there are some law firms. Because I told someone, like, oh, I printed everything. Say, oh, you're not supposed to print. I'd be like, oh, no, I love the way I printed. I knew how much, the volume of what I submitted. I knew I submitted everything. Yeah. Because another issue is I knew someone that submitted a petition, and when they gave him RFE, they were like, He submitted like 200 pages, and USCIS just cited like 50 pages. So the person, thank God the person was the one that submitted. If it was like the, like Rhemma that submitted for the person might say, oh, he submitted just 50 pages and charged me for 200 pages. Do you get that? So there should be an option of that in it. Then I know you're very busy with customer, because I have a friend also that is trying to get on your timetable, and I know you're busy also. So if there's a way in which we can actually reduce what do we call it? You know, in USCIS, you see there is a lot of wait time.
Wait list.
Yeah, so maybe we should try to reduce the wait list in your log, if there's a way in which we can do that. That would really help a lot of people to get up.
Yeah, currently we have about 3 more associates, and we are really increasing our pace. We've enjoyed our clientele, a lot of them. And so, yeah, that is something that we can definitely work on. Yeah. Regarding the printing, though, I think Obi will just send me a couple of dollars so that I can start printing as well. Well, I always say that we are nearing the end of the interview, but you know, let's say I'm an international student. I just came into the United States. Eventually, I would need this if I'm planning to stay on the long term. What would be your advice for me, given that you've gone through all this process?
Sorry, there are some feedback I'm hearing, Billy.
Okay, so just think of it that I'm a new international student. I just came all the way from wherever I am, like Africa, Asia, Europe, wherever. I just came in. Eventually, I know that I want to stay in the United States for a long term.
Yeah.
What advice would you give to me as an international student who is just starting school?
So, as an international that is just starting and thinking of staying or changing to an immigrant, you need to start working towards how to get petition ready, because this is the best way we can do it. With education, NIW is like the easiest way. And the most legal way, let me put it, because there are a lot of ways, but the most legal way is through EB2 and IW for now. So as soon as you hit the ground, you need to start making, even if it is volunteer work you can do, that can actually be added to your CV, that can actually, because volunteer can help in your petition. Things that you think might never make sense in your petition. So like, if it's helping fellows out in the lab, just to get your name included in abstract, because it's not about the person that was the lead one in the abstract. It's just about you being there. Whether a paper in which you can help people in the project, and they will include your name in the project, and you can actually use that. I believe that will work. Then also, meeting up with people of like minds that are there, that you know, okay, these people too are trying to stay. What way are you guys trying to migrate into the immigration realm of the United States? What ways, what method do you want to use? How well do you think I can do this? So you need to ask questions, basically, from people that are already here before you. Because I know one thing about we, especially Africans, is just that we don't like asking questions. Be like, I don't need to ask him. I can read about it. So there are people that have gone through different experiences. Experience is the best teacher. So they'll give you a better knowledge. But from me, I would say, immediately you get here, try to get yourself involved, though it can be a lot, but try to get yourself involved in one or two things. If it's just one abstract, if it's just one publication that can actually help, if it's just one community service, one volunteer, just to actually increase your chances of approval, I would say that's the best thing to do. Yeah.
And on the record, Obi has a lot of volunteering. For example, he volunteered to review some abstracts for conferences, for an abstract for journals. You know, he has done a lot of like those volunteering. So he himself did some volunteering. So you know, you can always reach out to some of these. He went for a couple of abstracts and conference presentation here and there, different scholarship. He volunteered to work on different projects that he was not necessarily the lead person. You know, there are different projects where he would like support, but because he contributed to it, then his impact is also being accredited and approved by the people that work on it. So like he said, like, get yourself involved in different things, get evidence, like, you know, if it's certificates, get them. If it's a receipt or something to show your involvement in that as well, you also get all of that. Yeah, so what I'll do is in the next couple of maybe 3 to 4 minutes, I'll open the floor for anybody if you have questions specifically directed towards Obi, is more than welcome. And if it's something that I think I can address it here and now, I will. If not, to you can definitely reach us we are also online on Rhemma Consult. I'm just going to put our information in here as well, so let me do. Yeah. So if you have any quick question you're wondering that I think will be answered in the next 2-3 minutes, then we'll be more than happy to answer it. If not, definitely, like you said, get yourself involved in different projects, different things, get evidence, and then hopefully immigration can be a thing of the past for you as well.
Yeah, thank you very much, Dr. Odro. My question is, could you tell us a little bit about the RFE and were there some specific things that they were looking for and how did you, fill up that gap to get everything done?
So for the RFE, do I want to do it or does Obi want to do it? Which one? Should I go for it or you go for it?
I didn't hear the question in which he asked.
So Isaac was asking, what did the RFE demand, and how did we overcome the RFE?
Oh, what they demand? Oh, they demanded for a lot of things. I won't lie. It's a 7-page RFE. They talked about recommendations, like getting recommendations from independent people. I remember that was one of it. They talked about the conferences, even reviewing articles for journals. Like, I remember one was like, you said you review article. What is the importance of being a reviewer? So we need to explain to them, like, why I review article and the importance, like, not just to my field, but even to the US as a whole. So I remember that was another one. Then they talked about the people in which I've worked with. Can I get, like, letters from them that can actually be sure that we actually did that? Then I remember putting in some grants, and they gave some excuses about the grant also. But basically, the thing they wanted was just a better understanding of what we did, a better understanding of how we did it, and the importance to the U.S. Because it all boils down to the importance to their country. So that's the major thing, yeah. But
yeah.
It's like 7 pages, so I'm just telling you, like, in summary of what is there.
Yeah. So yeah, just to add a little bit to what he said as well. So the RFE came in. RFE is not a new thing to Rhemma Consult. We do it all the time. The only new thing was that this time it came in from our clients. Most of the RFEs and all of the RFEs have always been from different clients who come in with their problems, or from lawyers who had issues and then we solve it. But I think, if I remember correctly, because it's been a while since we did this, but if I remember correctly, the RFE, I think, accepted the substantial merits, certain, I think, the national importance, but they questioned the well-positioned, which essentially talks about expertise. I believe some of the things as well may probably have been overlooked by the officer, or for some reason, the interpretations weren't really clear. And so what we did was to elaborate on those pieces. And, you know, Obi have worked with a lot of companies in the United States in his capacity of testing, doing products for different organizations, U.S. companies. So we also got some letters from them to attest that if Obi didn't do what he did for those companies, they won't be able to have these products on the market, right? So really talking about the impact of his work, specifically how it is benefiting U.S. companies as well. So those were some of the things that we highlighted. I believe we took a letter from one of the journals that he had reviewed to also highlight the implication of what he had reviewed and its impact to the field in general. So this was, you know, the whole thing about NIW and petitions, like having dealt with EB1, RFEs and NIW and all of those things, this whole process is an overwhelming process. It's not just for the clients themselves, but for, I believe, for the offices, because it's a lot of documentations, a lot of evidence, and sometimes things could be overlooked. But yeah, those were some of the things that were highlighted, and those were the rebuttals that we also wrote, and then the officer agreed that we had a case. And that's the nice thing about working with USCIS, like, there's a back and forth, right? It's not like a black hole that, hey, that's the end, right? Like, they give you an opportunity to explain if they think it's not convincing. Well, hopefully that answers your question. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Okay. I see who is it? Shayla, I'm a brother. Maybe Glenda. That's the easy one I can pronounce. Glenda,
okay.
Your hand is up.
Yes, Doc. Good afternoon. And
hello, afternoon.
I know I have a session with you on the 19th, but I just want to ask a quick question. I believe for Obi, from what I'm hearing, maybe he's a professor and he's into research. You know, this EB, National Interest Waiver, I think they have different runs. I've listened to so many things. I'm completely confused, honestly speaking, but maybe that's the reason why. Because when it comes to publication, she's done publication. Some of us, we don't have all these things, but I believe there are different categories as well. So you explain it to me on the 19th. But my quick question is, I just want to know, like, if you have somebody who has entered the country and have like 2 or 3 months to leave, and wants to the person wants to do this national interest waiver, do you still have to be, assuming the person stays, and you still have to be in status to apply for this NIV? I just want to know.
Yeah, so you asked a lot of questions.
Mm-hmm.
So let me try and remember those you asked.
No, maybe I should answer mine first.
Okay, go for it.
So she was like, maybe I'm a professor. I'm not a professor. I'm a PhD student, but I've actually taught before. I was also a research assistant back home. I was a research assistant in a university back home in Nigeria. I also worked for an NGO as a research associate back also in Nigeria before I came for my PhD. So I'm not a professor, please. I'm a student. I'm trying to be a doctor, an academic doctor. So, and also on the issue of publication. So I know Doki would be able to give a better answer on that, but one thing I would say here is it's not about publication. That's what I said initially, that even people without publication are actually getting this. And publication is not, some people, it's even, I remember a friend used newspaper publication, like they talked about him in newspaper. Like, I remember something just down, Doki. When we were applying, I didn't even remember to bring this up. So when I was back home in Nigeria, I got a travel grant to present my work in Europe. And we didn't even include that. And it was even in the bulletin of the university. It was someone that was just telling me, oh, yeah, you should have included that. So some things are like, we don't really think they are actually important, but they are necessarily important, no matter how little they are. Like, even if you're a teacher, I think basically an IW is just like bachelor's and 5 years of working experience, I think, if I'm not mistaken. So NIW is EB2. EB1 is not an IW. The one for professors is the EB1. Those are for the people that have, like, a lot of more accomplishments. But the EB2, like, I believe people with bachelor's with, I think, 5 years experience can apply for it. Doki, now it's your turn.
So, yeah, to bucket your final statement, yes. If you don't have a master's degree and you have a bachelor's degree and you've worked progressively for 5 years, that you meet the basis for the requirement, right? The only thing will be to show your expertise and the importance of your expertise. So yes, the first thing I'll say is that it is not only for like research and for professors. In fact, if you go back to one of our videos we have on YouTube, there was one person that came all the way from Ghana. He had no papers whatsoever, and he still got it. And then a couple of, I think in about maybe October or November, we're going to interview a couple of clients. My associate is going to be interviewing a couple of clients where they don't also have typical research background, but they do have different years of experience and they've worked on different things in their workplace, and they can show all of this. So it there is no way stated that it is for researchers. It's actually a matter of requirement, right? So if you meet the requirements, then you apply for it. So it is not really for researchers. It is for those who can meet the requirements. Yeah. Hopefully that answered your question. And then I think in the next, you said in the next
So do I asked if you have to still be in status to apply for it.
Well, for the first stage, it doesn't matter your status. But for the second stage, yeah, you would have to be in status. Yeah, but we'd have to discuss that. So I'll be more than happy to discuss that with you. I think you said 19th, right?
Yes,
I'll have to check the calendar. But yeah, I'll be more than maybe to understand your case and see which route we should follow as well. So I look forward to the meeting on 19th.
Thank you.
No problem. Okay, so I believe we are almost on the clock. It's been nice having you all here. Because this is always recorded, I always end up by saying one thing. Like so many years ago, I came to the United States with to study, and if I had known the information that OB knows now, probably would have taken a lot of different routes. So if you happen to watch this sometime in the future, just think about what your long-term goals are. If your long-term goal is to stay in the United States, look into it, look at how you can pair your background and your portfolio so that you can meet any of these requirements, and hopefully before you are done with school, you have it. And because sometimes when you are done with school and you're applying for jobs and you don't have green cards, sometimes, not always, sometimes it's a little bit difficult for certain companies. You know, the big companies like Walmart, Facebook, Amazon, they don't have a problem like sponsoring most people. But sometimes the smaller companies may not have what it takes to be able to sponsor. So being able to get this green card before completion of school or just when you are done with school is something that you need to also consider in the long term. Is it Tulane? I see on your hands up. If it's a quick one, I can answer because we want to close exactly by 2 p.m. Central.
All right. Thank you very much, Doc. Let me go in Obi's terminology, Docy. Really appreciate you organizing this, and thanks, Obi, for at least answering, kind of like sharing your own piece.
Where are you from?
Sorry, I'm from Nigeria.
Okay, the answer gave you away. Okay, go ahead.
No worries. I guess my own question is all about my having a BSc in physics, but ever since kind of like dumped it and went into project management for past 7 years now, but I didn't go for the whole master's, piece for advanced degree. I'm just wondering if there's a requirement to still go for the master's first before, coming your way for a session, or, if it's just a waste of time coming your, I'm just trying to decide which one to go for, whether to first go for the master's before setting up the session with you, or setting up the session with you to decide if I'm even a viable candidate in the first place.
Did you say you have 7 years?
Yeah, 7 years in project management, and a couple of, I think about five or six sats on the side.
I don't see why we should wait for a master's degree if you can show you have 7 years. But of course, I'm just taking your answer on the face value. So if you do have 7 years, then that's good enough. Yeah, we can go ahead. Yeah. You don't have to wait for.
No, in that case, I'll set up a session and then we'll just see how it plays out, if it's positive or negative, but whatever the case, we'll crack on from there.
Yeah, no problem.
All right. Thank you very much, Doc or Docy.
Okay. Again, the Nigerian friends and brothers. Well, it's been nice having you all. Thank you so much for your time. And that being said, bye for now, and hope our paths cross very soon.